Today, we will have two lectures back-to-back. In this session, I'm going to talk about dose reduction strategies in CT, and my colleague Beth Schuller is going to talk about radiation safety for patient staff in fluoroscopy. There is a fourth one in the series tomorrow morning. Keith Strauss is going to talk about pediatric CT, especially based on the AAP, upcoming AAPM task group report. So I would welcome all of you to attend the tomorrow session also on this series of this educational course. So having said that, let me start because I have quite a few slides. I want to not to take too much time. Myself and Beth is going to share this session. As most of you know, the radiation dose in CT is one of the highest viewed information or attended talks these days in any radiology or conferences now. Even in RSNA, in the past few years, we are seeing the number of abstracts in the CT. CT physics has increased almost linearly as much as the number of CT procedures done in the U.S. So why these radiation dose strategies are becoming important, especially these days, we as a physicist have been are kind of like required to pay more attention or pay more role, key role in helping our clinicians in helping to optimize some of the protocol. For example, probably you have all seen this one. This was the New York Times article published back in 2010, which has this CT perfusion images where patients underwent hair losses. Nearly 200 patients in one of the hospitals in California underwent. And in fact, probably you also know one of the hospital trustee also was one of the patients who underwent this hair loss. Having said that, after this article came, I know most of us have paid attention, went back to our clinic to look at the protocols, especially on the CT perfusion to make sure they're not delivering high doses. But it's kind of sad to see that after almost a year, in West Virginia Hospital, recently in March, there is an article where a hospital in West Virginia found out they were continuing to do the same procedures, and now they have found they were continuously radiating the patients with the same type of hair loss situation. And the way they came to know is because there was a class action lawsuit. The lawyers were trying to contact different hospital, and when they came to West Virginia Hospital, somebody in the patient had this hair loss. So it's kind of unfortunate that even after all these high-profile news articles, this was kind of like a dropped in between case these things happen. The other situation which is also drawing a lot of attention is like it's not the radiation dose from one particular procedure is key, is the number of patients who get repeat CT scans. And this is one of the studies published in radiology back in 2009. Basically looked at a 22-year retrospective study about 30,000 patients, trying to see how many of these patients had multiple CTs. And if you see here, the main point which I want to draw here is like 22 scans in 5% of the population, and nearly 1% of the population received more than 38 scans. It's not very unusual, but that's what the reality is. And some patients get over and over of these scans because they're brought back to the clinic more often for repeat scans and so forth. So as a physicist, especially, if they talk about CT doses, I'm not that concerned about a person, patient getting one scan or two scan. We can put our efforts on situation where they are getting some percentage of the population getting a lot of scans. Therefore, in this particular population, 15% received more than 100 millisievert. And among that, the more CT of the abdomen and pelvic is the most commonly repeated exam among the patient. Because of that, even the ECRI this year listed the CT scans as one of the top health technology hazards in 2011, high radiation dose of CT. Even though the radiation dose in CT is coming down per procedure, but the perception, the number of CT exams done is still high. So what are the important thing in terms of the dose reducing strategies we all can adopt or help our clinicians to mitigate some of these high radiation dose issues? One is this: optimization of the MDCT protocols require thorough understanding of all technical factors or aspects of CT. It's very important that we understand various factors, especially the relevant scan parameters which can impact the radiation dose and image quality. Second is, like, it's also equally important to understand the dose reduction strategies or techniques, and to also come to awareness of some of the new technological advances now we are coming in forefront, which are going to help even further reducing radiation doses. The scan and technical parameters are supposed to be tailored to match the patient size, the body region, and clinical questions. That actually has been in the limelight from past 5-6 years, where prior to that, all the protocols were uniform across the board, whether it's a pediatric or adult, and that's changing now. And one thing which we all had to understand is the diagnostic image quality should not be compromised in the effort of reducing dose. If in a clinic, if they unilaterally reduce the dose, the image becomes quite noisier, and if the diagnosis is poor, then the physician might have to call the patient for a repeat CT exam. In that case, it defeats the whole purpose of reducing dose. So it has to be the image quality and radiation dose has to be balanced in equivalence so that the image quality is not compromised. There are a variety of dose reduction strategies. In the 30 minutes talk, I cannot cover everything, but I'm going to talk about the salient features. The more thing is like the optimal tube current selection. Among the optimal tube current selection, the dose modulation strategies have matured quite a lot in the past 5 years, wherein now the latest scanners with 16 and 64 slice scanner, the dose modulation techniques work fairly well for most patients. The new things which is coming across the board is the reduced tube voltage in suitable patient. Again, this has also been advocated quite heavily for thin patients. Especially in the cardiac CTs, there are a number of publications in the cardiac world which the clinicians have shown that, especially the patients are thin, they are to use the reduced tube voltage for the benefit of radiation saving radiation dose. Of course, the minimized scan region is a very important thing because as a physicist, we can help our technologists and the users to make sure the scan is minimized so that itself it indirectly provides direct dose reduction. Dynamic collimation is a new technology which is now most manufacturers are bringing in. And among the cardiac imaging, there are a variety of ways we can reduce dose based on the type of acquisition. And I'm going to talk a little bit about iterative reconstruction and dose check. Other phenomena. I kind of group these various factors into this which affects radiation dose and image quality. Among them, I try to group these primary factors which have direct impact on the radiation dose and image quality. There are secondary factors and other factors. When I give this slide to the radiology and cardiology community, I tell this training and experience are now is very key in types of understanding or reducing radiation dose and image and improving the image quality, because that's also becoming very important. Among the primary factors, as most of you know, the tube current is an indication of the quantity of X-rays produced in the X-ray tube, and tube voltage is an indication of the quality of the X-rays produced in the X-ray tube, as we all know. So the tube current is one of the primary factors which should be the first step to look into reducing doses, because the tube current has a linear relationship with respect to radiation dose. So if you double the MA, it increases the dose by double. If you reduce the MA by 50%, the radiation dose increases by 50%. The tube voltage has a little bit more complicated relation than the linear relation of the tube current. Tube voltage varies to the kVp to the power of 2. And of course, the same time is the scan time and pitch. Understanding how these parameters work or affect radiation dose and image quality is key for making more suitable changes in the protocol to reduce radiation dose. With the time, among the tube current modulation, the main one of the things which is the CT dose modulation, I'm going to talk a few minutes about this particular strategy to reduce dose. The tube current is also called as automatic tube current modulation. Different vendors give different names. They call it smart MA, dose, care dose, sure exposure, ZDOM, and different nomenclature. But the basic principle among these things is to reduce or vary the tube current based on the body sizes across the body. As we all know, the average size body is not circular, so it's more of an elliptical shape, so that the attenuation in different direction is different, so the tube current can be varied as the tube is going around the body to collect the information. For example, as shown here, the tube current as a function of time during the sparsity of a pediatric patient. As you can see, around the shoulder region, the tube current increases to maintain the same image quality, and the tube current decreases around the chest area part because of the less attenuation through that part. By doing so, the system automatically can reduce the load. There are certain caveats to using this dose modulation technique. The 4-slice scanner and below that, the technology was not that mature, but now with the 16-slice scanner and 64-slice multi-detector CT, the dose modulation techniques are quite matured by the vendors, and they can be universally adopted for most of all the adult patients. If you're doing it on a pediatric patient, some carefulness has to be taken when adapting this dose modulation uniformly across the in pediatric protocol. The reason is, in pediatric protocol, the pediatric CT scans require special attention, especially positioning of patients. The patients has to be in an ISO center to get the maximum benefit of the dose modulation. And it has also become very important when you are defining the reference MAS, because if you are using dose modulation technique and you have some reference MAS as required by some vendor at a high level, that the doses can increase also. So careful has to be, one has to be careful when applying dose modulation for pediatric cases. It is also important sometime to make sure that the automatic tube current modulation is really effective. Or can you reduce the dose reduction by simply changing the scan parameter? For example, very low dose screening techniques like lung screening trial and everything, the dose modulation technique is not necessary to be used. We can just simply reduce the MA quite low to get for some of this technique. That's what one of the things was done in the national lung screening trial, where the MAS was reduced to very low to get to achieve the low radiation dose. The relationship with respect to radiation dose and image noise, I just want to show one image here. These are the four different abdominal images taken at different MAS level. As the MAS decreases, overall image looks good. But for example here, the attention I want to draw here is like the renal cyst, which the radiologists are watching here, are pretty much observable in all the four levels. They're not compromised at all. So even with the 50 MAS, the radiologists are able to see the renal cyst. However, when it comes to this, the liver, conspicuity with respect to the small liver vessels here, that conspicuity decreases as the image noise increases. So the point here is like, if the protocol, if the physicians are looking for a renal cyst only, then there is no need to do it at 200 MAS. They can directly go to 50 MAS till still there. On the other hand, if they are also looking some type of a small liver vessels intrusion at this particular point, we had to make sure that they are not completely reduced unilaterally, because that can jeopardize the image quality. So there has to be a balance. For example, if the physicians or radiologists are comfortable seeing the vessels at this particular 100 MAS, and that's where the balancing act comes into picture of optimizing some of this protocol, where the protocols need to be optimized or tailored to the question the radiologists are asking. So that's the direction we need to take. The next important strategy is the dose reduction by tube modulation technique. Again, there are a number of publications coming out in radiology and other AJR talking about the new way the manufacturers are now beginning to experiment with this modulating the tube voltage. Up till now, we are seeing the capability of modulating the tube current only with keeping the tube voltage same. But now the next level is like not only to change the modulation, the tube current, but there's a possibility to change the modulate the tube voltage also. And again, as a physicist, we know lowering the tube voltage improves image contrast and can reduce dose. But again, it depends on the area of your scanning. And as the tube voltage decreases, the tube current has to be increased to maintain the same image noise. So if you just not only decrease the tube current and also decrease the tube voltage, image can be too noisier. So in cases of when we are lowering the tube voltage, either manually or automatically, the tube current has to be increased slightly to maintain the image noise. And especially this is becoming very effective during CT angiography procedure. There are a couple of publications going to has already appeared and it's going to come a couple more in the months, which is showing the effectiveness of modulating the tube voltage, especially for CT angiography procedure. And this is a new feature the vendors are bringing along to further reduce the dose. For example, here is one publication which is kind of talks about the advantage of reducing the tube voltage and how it balances with the image contrast also. This particular publication basically discussed how the contrast, especially the iodine contrast, changes with respect to the tube voltage and how the noise can also increase if the tube voltage is unilaterally decreased without ramping up the tube current. And there is a balance between the contrast noise ratio versus the KVP at the same dose level, how it varies for a small, medium, and large body. And again, this particular handout, I'm going to post it on the website. So any of these references, I would welcome all of you to check out these references. They have very valuable information, especially not only for teaching residents, but also for our understanding of these features. The overranging in CT scan is also very critical. In fact, that's one of the things, irrespective of the parameters, the overranging, understanding the overranging is important, because if you look at this one, in this particular publication, the author very, very nicely describes the effect of the overranging, especially in the helical CT scans, and how even though you're doing a certain level of helical scans around the chest, for example, a 30-centimeter chest length, if you're doing a helical scan, usually the radiated area is more than 30 centimeter. That's what this overranging phenomena comes here. And that's here, for example, here, this is the total, even though this is the image length, the total image length scan here is this particular area, the total exposure scan length is part. So there is actually certain overlap, especially because of the helical scan, plus also in order to maintain uniformity across the multi-detectors, the scans, there is some overexposure on the either side. And this generally increases with collimation and pitch, and overranging may lead to substantial but unnoticed exposure to radiosensitive organs, especially if they're doing a chest and if you can have this thyroid exposure and so forth. One of the ways the vendors are now adapting to this to mitigate this overranging is by doing what is called as the adaptive dose shield, or also called as dynamic collimation. And most of these vendors are now coming up with these things, and now the later scanners are available. The way it works is like, in a conventional CT scan, the pre-patient collimator results in overscanning. There is some overscanning because of the helical scan. The adaptive dose shield, or also called as dynamic collimator, basically has a traction metal or the lead collimation which covers the X-ray beam until it actually enters the actual scan region, and then the blade retracts. Therefore, this overranging part is actually not exposed, that unless the outside the scan region is not exposed, and that going to have an impact on further reducing this exposure to the unnecessary area which we are not used for imaging. And that's kind of very nicely explained in this particular manuscript, basically telling like, in a conventional collimation where there is no dynamic collimator, even though you're only scanning the cardiac area, for example, here is only limited to the chest area, the cardiac area, you're exposing outside because of the helical ramp up and ramp down feature. With a dynamic collimation, this collimator blade are brought in until it is reaching the actual scan region, and then the blades are retracted, and then you're only exposing the area which is needed for the image, and then brought in back again once the end of the scan region is reached. So there, automatically, this additional amount of overexposure is avoided. See, the next part is the radiation dose reduction using cardiac CT imaging. Among the cardiac CT imaging, it's important to see what type of acquisition mode one is using. There are two ways of doing cardiac imaging. What the most commonly done is the retrospective ECG gating. The way it's done here is like the entire heart is covered. As the scanner is acquiring the data through the heart area, radiation exposure occurs through the entire heart scan time, and the data is collected throughout the R cycle. After that, retrospectively, you're reconstructing only part of the data and rest of the data is thrown out. And that has been the most common way of doing this cardiac CT imaging, and that's called as retrospective ECG gating. The good part here is, like, if there is a uneven heartbeat between one of these bed position, the data can be salvaged by either reconstructing the data from this part or this particular part. However, the radiation dose is higher because you are radiating the radiation heart throughout the heart cycle and using only part of the data to reconstruct. The second way of doing cardiac CT reconstruction or image acquisition is what is called as prospective ECG triggering. The patient heartbeat is monitored, and the scanner is asked to trigger at a certain point from the RR peak, like either it's a manual or a fixed point, wherein the X-ray is turned on only part of the time, and you're acquiring the data which is needed for image reconstruction. There is some cushion on either side of this part, and you acquire at each bed position, and if you and the scanner automatically waits for a quiescent heartbeat and acquires until it covers the entire heart cycle. Because of which this other part is not radiated, there automatically the radiation dose is minimized. The caveat here is, like, if there is an uneven heartbeat, sometimes you can have a data gap which may trigger to have a repeat scan. However, that's been now been commonly used. The advantage of the prospective versus the helical retrospective gated here is, for example, in this particular just one image. For example, this is the three bed position to cover the entire heart done in a prospective triggering method. And this is the same heart scan was done with a helical scan. As you can see here, the helical scan, there is a ramp up and ramp down. Plus, with the helical acquisition in cardiac CT, we do a lot of overlapping. Because the overlapping means that we have a very low pitch value, the radiation dose is higher. So the radiation dose, for example, the effective dose for a CT angiography done in a prospective trigger method is now around 4 to 6 millisievert, whereas if you do in a helical retrospective gated method, it can be between 12 to 15 millisievert. And that's where we have seen the reduction dose in the cardiac CT imaging by moving towards what is prospective triggering method. Further dose reduction can be occurred by what is called as retrospective ECG gated technique. So in cardiac CT, the automatic tube modulation is not done so often. It's more of this ECG gated modulation is done. The way it works is, like, the patient heartbeat is monitored, and the scanner automatically lowers the tube current around the RR peak because that data is not utilized, and then it ramps up the tube current only at the area where you are collecting the data. Thereby, you can modulate the tube current based on the ECG signal, and that can have an impact of radiation dose reduction. In a prospective triggering, where you are only acquiring data in a small part, even there, you can actually further collimate. You can have all these parts is kind of totally negated, further reducing the radiation dose in the prospective triggering. With this wide detector scanners available now, with either the 320 scanner or the 256 scanner, now it has made possible to cover the entire heart in one rotation. Basically, one sweep around the heart, you cover the whole heart. Because of that, there is no overlapping of the tissue. The dose has come down. Plus, you can further reduce down, either you can change the tube current further down, only acquiring this portion, reducing the dose quite dramatically, and you are seeing literature sometime telling it we're doing cardiac CT imaging at sub-millisievert levels. But historically, we're doing cardiac CT at 12 to 15 millisievert. We are now able to do cardiac CT at 3 to 5 millisievert comfortably with around all the patient. The same thing is now achieved with the dual-source CT scanners. Also, the dual-source CT scanners, the purpose there also is to acquire the entire heart in one rotation. So basically, the table moves very fast at about 40 millimeters per rotation, and it can cover the entire heart in one single heartbeat, and that provides further possibility to reduce dose quite dramatically. Of course, the vendors have also introduced beam-shaping filters. Typically, in most CT scanners, there are like three filters, the bow-tie filters, small, medium, large filters. Now, with some of these scanners designed purely for doing cardiac CTs, vendors have also introduced what is called as cardiac filters, further shaping the bow-tie to concentrate only on the heart area, so which allows further reduction in the radiation dose. Iterative reconstruction All of you may have been hearing a lot about iterative reconstruction. Vendors have already introduced this iterative reconstruction methodology. In the past, it was not, radiologists did not want to bother with the reduction in the image noise, but in the past few years, because of the radiation dose awareness, they are now able to accept this iterative reconstruction methodology for a number of two things. One is the concern about radiation dose. Second thing is the computing capability have increased quite a lot. Therefore, this iterative reconstruction can be done on the fly. Here, so historically, we're doing conventional filtered back projection technique, and now image reconstruction for those working in the area of nuclear medicine, the iterative reconstruction has been the way from the past so many years. And only now recently we are seeing in the CT also where we are able to do iterative reconstruction wherein we can acquire the data at a much lesser 1/4 to 1/5 of the MAS done for a normal CT and then refresh the image reconstruction through this iterative reconstruction process wherein to create the same image noise without having to have the compensate for the radiation dose. For example, here, the coronal image of this standard reconstruction with a certain MAS, with after two iterations, the image noise is decreased, and then we can basically, the image noise is much more nicer, but the advantage here is like you are doing the radiation dose at a much lower. Here is an example here. This is done at 120 MAS with a full dose pressure of the abdomen of the liver, and this is done at 50% dose with the conventional filtered back projection. The image noise looks like this. However, with the image iterative reconstruction, you can acquire the similar image quality image, but now with the gain an advantage of reducing dose further. There are dual energy CT techniques are now been done by a variety of vendors in a different way. And again, dual energy technique, we have been talking quite a while, and now it's still not universally done in the clinic, but it's been getting there in certain select protocol. Especially in one protocol, especially, for example, in some state, some situation where patient get triple phase studies, where they have this liver studies or something which is a 3 scan per exam, they have a single run followed by with contrast delayed and with and without contrast and also delayed phase, in which case if this acquired by the dual energy, the idea here is like the non-virtual image can be reconstructed virtually, thereby can avoid one scan. Again, these are experimental or in the research field being experimented to see whether it can be feasible, but it is possible now. So I'm going to sum up my talk. Basically, there are a lot of other positive developments which all of us has to be aware, such as the image gently, which concentrated on the efforts and is a social media campaign, which became a very successful campaign for understanding about the radiation dose in pediatric CT. And now there is a newly started image wisely for the adult protocols also. There is a lot, probably have seen that, wherein these websites have a lot of useful resources for physicists or the radiologists to understand some of the things. One example is the American College of Radiology also have this appropriateness criteria. Many of us are involved with these things. And of course, the CT accreditation program, which now also uses the CT doses on these standard protocols as a pass-fail criteria. Appropriateness criteria are very helpful these days because this is now slowly migrating into a physician ordering system so that when they order it, they will have this information. For example, a CT colorectal cancer screening. In addition to the appropriateness criteria now, with the help of the medical physicist involved in the ACR, now they also have what is called as the relative radiation levels for each of these procedures. So therefore, the physician ordering this exam have an awareness about the radiation levels involved in each of these protocol, which seem to be quite helpful for understanding some of this risk. Image gently and image wisely, I'm going to skip. The other features which is going to come across are slowly is the dose check. After with all these high-profile cases in CT, the manufacturers are going to roll in, are about to roll in what is called as dose check, which is basically an upgrade on the software, upgrade on the system, which will allow the user to set certain limits on the CTDI volume and DLP and so forth. Therefore, if somebody accidentally changes the protocol by setting up this incorrectly or accidentally, the scanner will warn this user that they are above the set level. Which is the idea here is like in the cases where they had the skin burn and hair losses in the CT perfusion scan, where the techniques were incorrectly set, that could have been avoided if the possibility with the dose check. So these programs will have the capability not only to set individual levels of the CTDI and DLP values, it will also have the capability to track changes. So if somebody accidentally changed it, they need to sign on that one. So retrospectively, you can do a quality control on a weekly or a monthly basis to make sure these protocols are not incorrectly set, thereby delivering accidental high dose levels for a long time. The last part which I want to stress is, especially this slide which I tried to show to our physician colleagues, is the impact after implementing radiation reduction technique. In fact, this was a multi-center study by the cardiology group in Detroit, where they do a lot of cardiac CT. And the cardiologist there took a time evaluating this radiation dose in the patient, and the average dose was around 25 millisievert, 20 to 25 millisieverts in cardiac CT done in a retrospective helical gated. Then they took what is called as like a 10-step program, like basically developing this very tight schedule for the users and the cardiologists to select the patient, select the protocol, minimize the scan region, and do the have a quality control, and they have a medical physicist involved in their protocols. And having done that, after 15 months, they were able to demonstrate that the radiation dose overall to their patients have gone up from 25 millisievert to less than 15 millisievert. In fact, there is a follow-up publication going to come this year, where now they have demonstrated the cardiac CT is down. They are able to do in a population to about 5 millisievert. So the radiation dose trend in their patients have come down because of this education awareness situation. The Cardiac CT Society recently put out a radiation guidelines for the doing cardiac CT for cardiologists. And in that one of the recommendations they do is like individual sites should consider developing site-specific algorithms for radiation dose optimization, which should be reviewed and revised if needed at least annually. And similar things are going to be done, are being done across the board, and where we are getting more and more involved or has been asked to get more and more involved in doing this situation. In conclusion, radiation dose from CT is of a concern and has been in the limelight recently. The optimization of CT protocols are key. So it's not that now it's not just sufficient for us to go and do a CT scanner evaluation. Now we are being asked more to interact with understanding this protocol, explaining to our physician colleagues how we can help to reduce further. So not only we are now being had to do the CT scanner evaluation, but our role is now increasing further to help with the protocol understanding. The dose report is another issue which is coming forward front and center. And understanding radiation issues and justifying appropriateness of imaging is becoming critical. I just want to show you here, it's like benefits of diagnostic radiation across the board outweighs the danger. However, we need to make sure all effort to optimize this protocol. So let me stop here. And I would like to welcome Dr. Beth Schuller from Mayo Clinic to speak on the second talk. Thank you.